look with you at this passage this evening, just to kind of take a little bit closer look at the throne room that Ezekiel is seeing, so that you can understand why it is that the book of Ezekiel starts out with this picture. If you go back, just go back to verse number 15. We'll you know, he starts out, he sees the storm coming. He's in the storm. He sees the glory of God, the God of the glory of the God of Israel, and he also sees these four living creatures, and they literally are carrying the throne of God. When he sees it, and the whole issue with these creatures is who they are and what they're doing. And in the passage, the passage is not designed to show you everything about the throne room. It's showing you that the throne is being transported. And that's the issue here. Verse 15, he introduces the creatures to you, the living creatures, verse 5 through verse 10, 11. Verse 15, start in verse 11. Thus were their faces. They've got those four faces. Each one of the cherubim have those faces. And these guys are cherubim. You know that in chapter 10, when he sees them again, and he calls them the living creatures, which are cherubim. By the way, the word cherubim is plural. Cherubim, cherub is singular. Cherubim is the plural form. You don't put an S on it to make a plural. It's one of those English words that's kind of weird. Verse 11, and thus were their faces, and their wings were stretched upward. Two wings on either one were joined to another, and two covered their bodies. And they went, every one straight forward, whither the Spirit was to go. And they went, and they turned not when they went. As for the likeness of the living creatures, when he talks about that, the wings are out like this. And what's happened, there's a platform on which the throne of God sits. And these cherubim are underneath the platform. They're on each corner. And their wings, they have the four wings, and two wings extend out from one way, one wing this way, one that way. The one standing there, he's got his wing out that way, out this way. So that literally they form a square or a box underneath the platform that the throne is on, and that's why it's called the chariot of the cherubim. These cherubim, their function here in this passage is to transport. They're the underlying transport mechanism for the throne of God that's on top of them. And when he talks about cherubim, Genesis 3, first time they show up, verse 24, they show up in the Bible, and they're placed at the way back into where the tree of life is. And it says that they're to keep the way. Their job is to guard the access to God's presence. In Hebrews chapter 9, when he talks about the cherubim in the tabernacle, and he calls about the cherubim of the glory of the God of Israel. That is, their association is with God's, in this passage, verse number 28, the appearance of the bow that was in the cloud in the day of rain, so was the appearance of the brightness round about, and that's round about the throne, verse 26. There was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord. The glory of the God of Israel has to do with his throne. The cherubim have to do with guarding the throne of God. They have to do with interfacing with the government of God's activity. And those four faces have to do with the representation of the government of God has to be executed in the earth. So when you're reading about the cherubim and the throne, they're guardians of the throne, they're transporters of the throne, sort of like the Secret Service. If you want a kind of a modern day, that'd be better than the Secret Service. Isn't it amazing? We've all been fed this line that the FBI, the most pristine, most prestigious law enforcement agency. Herbert Hoover did that, not Herbert. Is that I'm okay. He made out like they're the greatest thing going. And, I remember years ago reading about the FBI laboratory. It's supposed to be this number one crime. And one of their technicians is complaining. He's a whistleblower about insulation getting out, coming out of the roof, out of the ceiling, and contaminating things. Oh no! And you think, you know, now you see, you say, wow, you know, these guys are, it's really spooky. The Secret Service is supposed to be the, you know, the guardians of the president. And now you read about them, and they're, you know, they go off somewhere, and they're all drunk off in a hotel somewhere, shacked up with somebody that's not their wife, and you think, what's going on? You know what's going on? It's called flesh. That song you sang a minute ago about glorious freedom, they don't have any of that freedom. Well, these guys aren't that way. These are righteous, holy, defending the holiness and the right. These are the real deal. And one of their functions is to transport the throne. And that's what we're reading about here. It's the issue of transporting the chariot of the cherubim. 1 Chronicles 28 talks about it. Psalm 18, verse 10, it says the Lord, he travels on the chariot. And his throne, the throne of God in your Bible is designed to be moved, to be transported. And there's some reasons for that. And as Ezekiel's going to talk about that. We're going to see a lot about that in the next chapter. But in this chapter, you're seeing the transporting. And it's fascinating. You know, we've been down through these verses. Verse 12, they went everyone straight forward, whether the Spirit was to go. They went, and they turned not when they went. They don't turn. If you look at chapter 10, when he sees them again, there's a verse there that kind of sheds some light on that. Chapter 10, verse number 10. And as for their appearance, they forehad one likeness, as if a wheel had been in the midst of a wheel. It's like a gyroscope. And when they went upon their four sides. They turned not as they went, but to the place whither the head looked, they followed. In other words, you got these, each on each corner, you got these guys, and they got four faces. One guy's face, one face is this way, the next guy, his face is out. So on every corner, all four of those faces are looking out. They don't have to look around and see what's going on. They don't have to move. They can go in any direction instantly. They're full of eyes. They have all the awareness of what's going on. They're completely aware of the surroundings. They don't have to stop. You know, I don't know about you, but every time my wife and I go somewhere, I'm always getting instructions about where I'm supposed to turn, where I'm not supposed to turn. Why did you turn here? Why didn't you turn there? Kind of thing. These guys don't have any of that. Instantly, they know where and what to do. Verse 13, for as the likeness of the living creatures, their appearance was like the burning coals of fire, like the appearance of lamps. It went up and down among the living creatures, and the fire was bright, and out of the fire went forth lightnings. They've got, you know, combustion engine to take care of themselves, internally fuel. And the living creatures ran and returned as the appearance of a flashing of lightning, the instant speed. And as for the and as I began beheld the living creatures, behold, one wheel upon the earth by the living creatures with his four faces, and the appearance of the wheels and their work was like unto the color of beryl. And he describes what's going on down there. And what he's doing is he's describing the operating of the mechanism on which they're riding, the chariot that they're operating on. And it has instant access anyway, the wheels within the wheel, that's like I said, the gyroscope, where it can move anywhere, which way, instantly. Verse number 20, whithersoever the Spirit was to go, they went. Thither was their Spirit to go. And the wheels were lifted up over against them, and for the spirit of the living creature was in the wheels. Their operate the wheels, the mechanisms, their function, all responded to the Spirit that's in them. You know, we talk about being filled with the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, kind of thing. These guys are controlled completely and totally by their Spirit, and their Spirit is doing what understands what God wants done and responds to it. Verse number 22, the likeness of the firmament upon the heads of the living creature. So there's this firmament, this platform over their head was the color of the terrible crystal stretched forth over their heads. And under the firmament were their wings straight. the one toward the other. Everyone had two which covered on this side, and everyone had two which covered on that side their bodies. In other words, it's, in my mind, I picture it like a square platform, a square structure, support under the platform that's holding the throne. So you got a cherub on each corner, and their wings are protecting or supporting the throne of God. They don't need to turn around like this to see where to go. They've got instant access to all that information. You've got somebody looking forward, one guy looking forward, one guy looking left, one guy looking right, the guy behind. Every direction is covered, and so they're able to carry the throne of God, transport the throne of God. It's called a chariot of the cherubim. And as they go, verse 24, when they went, I heard the noise of their wings like the noise of great waters. So when they're going, it's that noise you hear. This thing's making some racket going through. You know, in military terms, they call it shock and awe. My grandson, we were at a baseball thing the other day, and one of the exercises they had him doing was they gave him a 5-foot piece of PCV pipe, and they said, I want you to swing that as hard as you can and make a lot of noise. And they did an exercise where for 10 times he swings the thing, and if he wasn't making enough noise, the coach says, more noise. In other words, the power of the wind going through there. Well, this is a powerful, impressive. Here comes the throne. Here comes God's throne. Now, verse number 25, there was a voice from the firmament that was over their heads when they stood and had let down their wings. And above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne, as the appearance of a sapphire stone. And upon the likeness of the throne was the likeness of the appearance of a man above it. So here you've got the throne of God. From that throne, all of the business of the universe, all of the entire universe is run. This is the throne of God. Just look one verse, 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles 29. Verse number 10. This is King David. 1 Chronicles 29, verse 10. Wherefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregation. And David said, blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory, and the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord. Thou art exalted as head above all. When Jesus taught his disciples to pray, thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever, that's the verse he was quoting. Israel understood that the God of Israel, the Lord God of Israel, was the ruler of all things, the creator. And his throne is where everything that operates comes from, the authority of his throne. And that's the throne Ezekiel is seeing. But the problem Ezekiel is seeing is that throne, that's the throne of the glory of the God of Israel, is leaving. It's being transported, but it's being transported out of the land of Israel, out of Mount Zion, out of Jerusalem, and it's going back to heaven. It doesn't belong in heaven. It belongs there in Jerusalem. That's where he intended it to dwell. That's why it was designed to be transported. When God made that throne in Genesis, he made it in order for it to come and dwell on the earth. Well, he brought it down. It dwelt in the earth in Israel, the tabernacle, the temple. But now it's leaving. Now the nation of Israel is being carried away into captivity. And when they do that, his throne's going away. You're in Ezekiel 1. Look at the chapter right before that, Lamentation chapter 5. In Lamentation, written by Jeremiah, after the destruction of Jerusalem, after Jerusalem has been carried away, he says in chapter 5, verse 16, the crown is fallen from our head. Woe unto us for that we have sinned. Literally, the crown that God had given to the nation, it would make them the head of the nations. He said, it's fallen. If you come over to Ezekiel chapter number 21, Ezekiel will say the same thing. Ezekiel 21 verse, I'll just do verse 25. Prophetically, this is the Antichrist. Ezekiel 21, verse 25, and thou profane, wicked prince of Israel, whose day is come, when iniquity shall have an end. Thus saith the Lord, remove the diadem, take off the crown. This shall not be the same. Exalt him that is low, and abase him that is high. I will overturn it, and it shall be no more, until he come whose right it is, and I will give it to him. So he takes the, by the way, in Ezekiel's day, the guy who is that profane, wicked prince is a guy named Jeconiah. And in Jeremiah chapter 22, God tells us, he tells Jeremiah, he says, you go tell Jeconiah, write him childless. Nobody, none of his descendants will ever sit on the throne. In fact, don't even call him Jeconiah anymore. Take my, the name Jeconiah is Jehovah, and that's what the J is about. He said, take my name off of his name. Just call him Keniah. Write him childless. The crown's gone. And from the seed of David, no man from that time on will ever sit on the throne. Now that's a problem when you understand the Messiah is going to be the seed of David. That's a problem that requires the virgin birth. Because the virgin birth, Joseph is not the literal daddy. Joseph is the descendant of David through Solomon, right to the throne. Mary is the descendant of David through his brother Nathan. So Jesus born of Mary is literally David's bloodline, but the crown line, the throne line, has been written childless. So how can David literally be the son of, how can Christ literally, the Messiah literally be the son of David, and yet sit on the throne of David if David's bloodline for the throne has been written childless? The only way that can happen is the virgin birth. So the virgin birth is required to accomplish what chapter 21 is talking about. It ain't going to be Israel's throne until he whose right it is comes. So the Lord is going to require the Messiah to be the one who can come and get the throne back. That's the point. So what's going on here in Ezekiel chapter 1 is really important in the working of Israel's program. But what's happening is that Ezekiel sees the throne room being transported away. And when we get to chapter 8, 9, and 10, you'll see it again where he talks about, where he'll see this vision again, and he'll see the glory literally departing, and then departing, and then departing, and then being gone. But when we looked at it, chapter 43, what do you see? You see it coming back, the throne of his glory coming back. And when Christ comes about the second advent, he comes with all the holy angels to do what? Sit upon the throne of his glory, which is what Ezekiel is seeing. So what Ezekiel is seeing is that throne of glory leaving, but it's only going to be gone temporary. So they're going to go off into captivity, and the throne's going to be taken away from them. But what Ezekiel sees is that throne leaving. But what he sees in verse 26, 27, 28, and 20 is that the throne leaves Jerusalem, but the God of Israel is still on the throne. And in chapter 20, 43, the God of Israel brings the throne back. Now, during Ezekiel, and the reason these dates, you know, verse 1 and 2, you see the date, these dates are important, is because Ezekiel's ministry takes place during a period of time. There are three captivities. The first one comes in, and then the second one, first one he takes away people like Daniel and so forth. Then he comes back because they don't submit. And in that second captivity, he takes Ezekiel away. It's not until the third siege that he actually destroys the city and everything and takes it all away. Ezekiel is in the middle there. Ezekiel's ministry is going to be between, he's come, he's taken Ezekiel and a bunch of them away, but the final captivity hadn't happened yet. So he's seeing the throne departing, but it didn't completely gone. So what he sees in chapter 1 is he sees that throne leaving, but it isn't gone quite yet. He's going to watch it happen. And through his ministry, he sees that destruction. But then at the end, he sees it come back. So what's happening in Ezekiel 1 is you're seeing the throne room where all the control of the universe comes from, where the crown of the Messiah resides, the crown that belongs to Israel, and you're seeing it depart from Israel. But God, the God of Israel, is still on the throne. He's eventually going to, in his time, bring that throne back. So what you're seeing in Ezekiel, come with me to the book of Revelation, chapter number 4. You're seeing the transportation of the throne out of Jerusalem, out of Israel, but the God of Israel is still on his throne. Why are they gone away? Because they violated him. He's doing exactly what he said. He's ruling like he said he was. And he takes his throne from the earth back to heaven. That's the reason when Jesus says, when you pray, say, "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." That's not where God was to be. It's not a good thing that he's in heaven. His place was to be in Jerusalem. His place that he desired to dwell is Mount Zion. That's the city of the great king. That's where his presence is supposed to be. That's where his promise is. But he's departed. Why? Because of Israel's unfaithfulness, and they've gone the captivity that he has brought on them, because that's what he told them he would do if they violated his covenant. So seeing the throne room go away is very impactful, and it means something special. So, and I know most of the time when people read Ezekiel chapter 1, they get all caught up in these cherubim and all the, you know, the wheels and the wheels and the spinning of the wheels and the wheel and the wheel and the side of the wheel and the whirling wheel and all that stuff. And they don't pay much attention to what it's for. But the cherubim, their main job is the guardians of the throne of God. In other words, they are instruments of God's government. It's all about his government, about the activities of his throne, the authority of his throne. And in Ezekiel 1, it's being taken away because they're going into captivity. Now, I just want you to see in Revelation chapter 4, I thought it would be helpful if we just spent just a little bit of time looking at exactly what it means to have that throne room, what's going on there. Because you get involved in the structure of the universe, how it's structured, why it's structured the way it is, and the things involved in its structure, and how it's operated. And these are things that you go back to Genesis chapter 1, you know, Ezekiel starts with it's a door in heaven opened, and you see things of that nature. And we live in a quote, scientific age, where we have our ideas about how the universe is structured, because you went to school somewhere and you learned some particular, you know, scientific observational approach and so forth. And sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't in the scripture, but the issue of what goes on in the throne room, here's the control center of everything. Revelation chapter 4 and 5 is an occasion where the final disposition of the question that's before the court is resolved. There's a question that's been before the throne of God, the courtroom of God. The throne room of God is literally, it's like a courtroom. It's the place where the decisions of the judge and the king are made. The court in which it's made. And that all of the questions, all the decisions, all of the deciding things down through time in Revelation 4 and 5 come to a final disposition. And what John does here is he combines the features of former courtroom sessions and puts them together here, because now the final one is going to be decided. Now, what's the question before the universe? The main theme of your Bible, from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, is the authority of a throne over the universe. Lucifer, when he became Satan, his rebellion was based upon he was going to be like the Most High God. He was going to take possession of authority, all the authority in the heaven and the earth. The Most High God is, in your Bible, is the one who possesses all authority in heaven and earth. He's the one that sits on that throne. And his is the power and the glory and the authority, and it's his will that gets executed. His purpose, why he created things, that's why things operate. That's how they operate. Lucifer said, no, I think I should sit on that throne. And the ultimate rebellion, the angelic rebellion, then rebellion in the unseen world between Satan and Jehovah is over the authority of who gets to sit on that throne. Satan's boast was, I'm wiser than you are, and I'm the one that has the wisdom to sit there, and you don't. Now, Satan, listen, if you can create a universe out of your word, you're obviously the most powerful. But we all know that power doesn't make right. Might doesn't make right. You all know what a bully is. Well, in scripture terms, Satan's boast was, look at me, I'm the wisest creature God made. Ezekiel 28. We'll get there and study. We've studied it many times before. I'm the wisest creature God ever made. There's no secret they can keep from me. That's what everybody told him. Look how smart you are. You're wiser than Daniel. There's no secret they can keep from you. Nothing happens you can't figure out. You're crafty. You're smart. Satan fell for it. And he decided, well, then I should be the one. And he went out among the angelic creation and built him a following and fomented a rebellion. All God himself had to do to destroy the wisdom of the wise one was to keep a secret. Satan said, you can't keep a secret from me. I can figure it all out. And God said, you'll never figure out my grace. So he kept a secret. And that secret, Paul said, if Satan had known the mystery, the secret, the hidden wisdom, he wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory, because it was the crucifixion of Christ that undid everything that he did. So Satan, he gets defeated. That's why the cross, the resurrection, are the defeat. They take from Satan all the things that he claimed. But the point is, that conflict has been there from the beginning. It's working toward a conclusion. And the declaration and the conclusion takes place in Revelation 4 and 5. Now is the point where we're going to disposit the issue and bring it to a conclusion. So you have a courtroom setting, a throne room setting, where we're going to have some final decisions made. So when you're thinking about these passages, think about them in that. This is governmental decisions to conclude and resolve things. I saw a thing on TV yesterday. Might have been this morning. It was late at night. Did you watch the series of things called the was it the Crown of Thrones? What was that HBO series? You're obviously not HBO subscribers. Yeah, what is it? Game of Thrones. That was it. See, I'm not. Anyway, it was Game of Thrones, and there was a session of it on last night, and I was watching it because it had these dragons. I thought, oh, look at that. Might be something you scare my grandkids with. And they had a scene after this big battle, where some people were coming before the queen, and she was granting them, you know, requests or killing them or whatever she needed to do. But it was a throne room. And they came there, made their case, and she made the decision, and that was this. Well, that's what you have a throne room, a place where decisions are made and finally disposited. Now, that's what's going on here. And you see this all through your scripture, but this is the final one, Revelation 4, verse 1. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. Now, Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 1, what happened? A door was opened in heaven, and Ezekiel gets his call. So this is the same kind of a situation. It's not the same event, but it's the same kind of event. And the first voice which I heard was, as it were, a trumpet talking with me that said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, now Ezekiel is going to be in the Spirit, the hand of the Lord is going to be on him, he's going to move in, same kind of situations. Behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat upon the throne. Now, when the throne was set in heaven, that doesn't mean let's set a throne up here. Come with me to Daniel chapter 7. When he says a throne was set in heaven, that's sort of like we're going to call the court to order. Daniel chapter 7, verse number 9. And again, what John is doing is he's gathering together all these things you'll see all through the scripture about these throne room situations, and John, you'll see them as you see them in John, in Revelation. Daniel chapter 7, verse number 9, I beheld till the thrones were cast down. Now that's the thrones back in the first part of that chapter, these Gentile thrones. And the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and his hair of his head like pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, his wheels as burning fire. Now there's God the Father, there's the throne that you're reading about in Revelation. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands ministered unto him. 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were open. The judgment was set. Court was called to order. And you got this big entourage watching. Well, that's what's happening in Revelation 4. The throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. So we're calling court to order. Revelation 4, verse 3. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and sardine stone. Not sardine the fish, sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne in the sight like unto an emerald. Now that's, if you go back to Ezekiel chapter 1, that's what you saw there. When it says the sardine, that sardine stone, it's in Ezekiel chapter 1. That's Exodus chapter 24, verse 10. We looked at that when we were studying that passage before. That's the appearance of the body of heaven. That's what they saw in the tabernacle when God's dwelling there. This is God the Father being sitting on the throne. There was a rainbow round about. Now that's you saw that rainbow back in Ezekiel 1. Brother Morris Chestnut for years has pointed out in Ezekiel chapter 1 that the glory of the throne of God was not just a white light. It was a light of a rainbow. Now, when you have a bow, a rainbow, where does that come from? That's Genesis chapter 9, after the flood. God gave a token of his purpose for man in the earth, that he would never destroy the earth again, but the rainbow was a token that God was going to accomplish his purpose for man in the earth. What's his purpose for man in the earth? To make him the king over the earth. But it's a rainbow. Now, there's two things about that. One, a rainbow shows up after a storm. So it's going to take some settling of some issues. That's why you see all the storm mentality figures back there about the storm and the lightning and all that kind of stuff. And it's also when water, a rainbow, you know what it is. It's water is the light that goes through the water crystals, and it's refracted. And you see all the various aspects, the characteristics, what makes up the light. So around the throne you have this multicolored light that shows you the characteristics of the light, and you see the characteristics of what makes up the light. Well, God is light, and him is no darkness at all. And what you see from the throne, you're going to see not just a physical light, but you're going to see all the things that make up his thinking, his character, who he is. Ezekiel and Exodus chapter 33 and 34, Moses said, I want to see, he says, show me your glory. In chapter 34, he made pass in front of him his glory, and he showed him his name. He showed him all that he was, and he tells you, I'm this, and I'm this, and he shows you all the characteristics of him. So that throne, you see all of the glory, all of who God is, how he thinks, what his purposes are. So John is seeing all of that, and it's right there. It's in heaven. By the way, the heaven that it's in is what we call the third heaven. Paul said, I was caught up into the third heaven. What's that? Genesis chapter number 1. In Genesis 1, he starts out creating the starry heavens. He calls that heaven. Then he creates creates the third heaven first, where God lives, where his house is. We studied that Sunday night in Hebrews chapter 12 about the city of the great king. But then there's the starry heavens, which we would call the second heavens. The Bible calls it the firmament. That's where he puts the sun, the moon, the stars. And then there's the open firmament. That's the atmosphere around the earth where the birds fly. So you have the atmosphere around the earth where the birds fly that's open to you and me. Psalm 115 says the heavens, the second heaven up there, you're not made for that. And you know that. You get up there, and you know, you get up 10,000 feet. You can't breathe. You have to have oxygen in a private plane. Big planes have to be compressed. You get up 10 miles, you step outside of a spacesuit, and you'll explode. Your body's not made for that. Then the third heavens, where God is, well, you're not made for that either. You got to have a new body for that. So where God's city is in that third heaven. It's called paradise. Psalm 20, verse number 6. Look at this verse. They're little quirky little verses in your Bible that, you know, you look at them and you say, wow, that's a neat way of saying that. Psalm 20, David says in verse 6, now know I that the Lord saveth his anointed. He will hear him from his holy heaven with the saving strength of his right hand. So where we are in Revelation chapter 4 is in the holy heaven, which would indicate there's a part of heaven that ain't so holy because there's some rebellion going on. So now you're in the third heaven. You're in the place called paradise. Paul talks being caught up there. And you're where God's throne is, where God's government comes from. And by the way, the government of God's, you know, hold your hand and come with me to Colossians chapter 1. I've said this to you. I've tried to teach you this for years. The government, the way the universe is organized. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. By him, and that's Christ, were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth. Visible and invisible. Some you can see, some you can't see. Whether they be, now notice what they are, thrones, dominions, principalities, and powers. All these things were created by him and for him. He was before all things, and by him all things consist. All the positions of governmental authority. The universe has a governmental system that God established, that this throne in Revelation 4 is designed to operate. It's in heaven and in earth. He says thrones, dominions, principalities, and powers on the earth. You can see them. You understand them? You do. He says they're the same kind of government, same kind of hierarchy, same kind of organization in the heavens. You can't see them, but they're there. And he uses exactly the same terminology to describe what's on the earth, to describe what's in the heavens, so that you can understand what's in the heavens by looking at what's in the earth. So there's this whole, this hierarchy in the government of the heavens, the government of the earth. This throne operates all of it, sets this standard. All authority in heaven and earth flows out of the throne of God. Now that's been contested, but God says that's where it all comes from. And we're going to find out in Revelation 4 and 5 if that's true or not. So the government is organized with positions and occupants in the positions. Hold on to Revelation and come on to Romans chapter 8. One other thing. There's a set of studies in there called Eternal Glory. If you've never studied through those things, this week get those videos and study them. It'll change your whole life, your whole perspective. Romans chapter 8, verse 37, verse 38. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers. You see principalities and powers? You see, that's over in Colossians 1. Thrones, dominions, principalities and powers. Then he says, but he also says angels. Now angels, that's a job description of some creatures in the spirit world. Messengers, ministers of God sent forth their spirits sent forth to minister to them who are heirs of salvation. A principality is a position occupied by a spiritual creature. So you have not just positions, but they're occupied by spiritual creatures. And the whole universe is that way. The creatures are the instruments of God's government. So when you come back to Romans 4, that's what the throne is about. Revelation 4, I'm sorry. I look at the clock. We got to hurry up. We're never going to get Revelation 4 and 5 done, are we? I keep talking too much. Verse number 3. He that sat was to look upon like a jasper. Now the one that's sitting on the throne is God the Father. Look down at chapter 5. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book. And he asked, "Can anybody open this book?" Verse number 5, one of the elders said unto me, "Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book, and to loose the seven seals thereof. And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders stood the Lamb, as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes." That's the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 7, he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne. That's God the Father. So the Lord Jesus Christ, the one sitting on the throne, says, "Who can open the book?" And the Lord Jesus Christ comes and says, "I can." So there you have Christ, and the one on the throne is the Father. That's how I know who's on the throne. Chapter 4, verse number 4. Not only that, and if you look at, when you look at all the things that you see here, the visage of what's there, it's fascinating. But what I'm trying to get to is the assemblage that's here. Verse 4, and around about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats, I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. Now, it's not like that seat sitting there, and then I'm sitting in it, or Alex is sitting in it, or Mario's sitting in it, or nobody's sitting in it. These seats are thrones around the big throne. And these guys are sitting in it. Why? They've come. Court's in session. What you literally have here is a gathering together of the members of the divine court that's going to adjudicate the case. 24 elders. Now they're not angels. They're sitting. The angels are standing, so they're not angels. They're in white raiment. They're worthy. Chapter 3, you got, they're in white because the crowns, they have authority. There are 24 of them. All kind of speculation about who they are. Okay? I give you my opinion. It's my opinion. It's worth as much as your opinion, but, you know, that's all it is, my opinion, because there's no real clarity about it. 1 Chronicles chapter 24, David divided the priesthood in Israel and the magicians in Israel into 24 courses, 24 sections. In Ezekiel chapter 8, Ezekiel sees 24 men in the temple, the courses of the priesthood. So what you have here is, what you have there is an illustration of how God organizes the government of his nation. So the probability is that the 24 elders are overseers of the divisions of the government of the universe. Revelation 21, in New Jerusalem, there are 12 apostles and there are 12 tribes of Israel. So there, and by the way, in Ezekiel 32, and I hate to quote verses and not look at it, but when God divided up the nations in the earth, he did it according to the number of the children of Israel. How many is the number of the children of Israel? 12. So when he divided up the authority in the earth among the Gentiles, the division was 12. If what's in the earth is reflected in the heavens, how many divisions would there be in the heavens? 12 here. What reflected up there would be how many? 12. I would just suggest to you that 12 of those elders represent God's government in the earth. 12 represent his government in the heavens. So you'd have a corresponding. You have the council who he has designated as part of those who are exercising authority in his government in the universe. So you've got the Supreme Court gathered together, as it were. Verse 5, out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunders, voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. So out of the throne, you have all these, the lightnings, thunderings, voices. If you go in chapter 8, when they'll do some of that kind of thing. And what that is describing, the orders are going out. And, you know, decisions are being made, orders are going out, decrees are being offered. We'll see next time in Ezekiel's commission, call to the ministry, he's identified he's going to be a watchman. Well, one of these creatures that are here, that are, he talks about the seven spirits of God. Well, that's we'll talk about that next time, but the seven spirits of God, you see, the spirit is capital. Chapter 1, verse 4, when he talks about the seven spirits of God originally, he says in chapter 1, verse 4, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ. Well, there's God the Father. Then there's the Lord Jesus Christ, and between it is the seven spirits. God the Father is sending grace and peace. Jesus Christ is sending grace and peace, and the seven spirits are sending grace and peace. Who would you logically assume that is? The Holy Spirit. Between the Father and the Son would be the Spirit. And who else would be able to send grace and peace the way the Father and the Son would? But you say, well, why in the world would we call the seven spirits? Well, we'll talk about that next time. But what you're going to discover when you find that out, if you look down at verse number, all right, now I don't. Verse 5, out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. Well, when it says which are, obviously it means it represents, because the lamp isn't a spirit. But it represents, the lamps represent what the ministry that the Spirit of God is operating before, and you see it says there were seven lamps before the throne. Here's the Spirit of God before the throne of the Father, and He's represented His job, His executive role in the government is to be these lamps. Well, when you have a lamp, what do? You shed light on stuff. You reveal stuff. He says, the eyes of the Lord run to and fro in the earth, beholding the good and the evil. The Holy Spirit's job before the throne, and by the way, before the throne, the Lord Jesus Christ is before the throne as the Lamb. The Holy Spirit's there too, before the, that's the willing submission of the Godhead to itself. It's not denying His personality or something. How does He function in the government? He literally functions as an overseer of a group of people that are called watchers. They go out into the earth and watch. We'll see those next time. Because you know what Ezekiel is called to be? A watcher. Ezekiel is going to do in Israel what these angelic creatures do. He's literally going to be doing the job. So all these things that you see here, when you go back to Ezekiel, you begin to find out, see, Ezekiel is seeing something that the next chapter, God says, you see what that was? You know what? I'm going to make you one of the watchers in Israel. And you're going to be one who goes over here and does these things. During the period of time, while they aren't gone, and they aren't gone yet. They're going into captivity. But if they were to respond positively, they could miss it. So I got you out there watching to see, beholding the good and the evil, just like He has the angelic watchers out there. So, anyway, verse 6, and before the throne there was a sea of glass, like unto crystal. That's what that verse in Ezekiel that's so kind of a another one of those kind of weird verses. The terrible crystal. When He says terrible, He's not talking about ooh, boo, bad, hiss. He's talking about it's dazzling. Before the throne is literally on a sea of glass that's dazzling. It's transparent. You can see through it. And the light that comes through it, that sea of glass, and it will, well, we won't look at it, but you could, if you go back in the book of Job, it's the top of the firmament in the universe. It's frozen like a crystal sea. That's where God's throne is here, at the top of the universe. Now you get to verse number 7. Now you got the four beasts. Now we got the cherubim showing up. The first beast was like a lion, the second beast like a calf, the third beast had the face of a man. And the fourth beast had was like a flying eagle. And the four beasts each had their six wings about them, and they were full of eyes within. And they rest not day nor night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts gave glory and honor and thanks to Him that sat upon the throne, who liveth forever, the 24 elders fall down with Him, before Him that sat on the throne, and worshiped Him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. You get to reign because you're the King, because it's your right to reign. And those four beasts, those four living creatures, and by the way, they have six wings instead of four wings like in Ezekiel. In Isaiah 6, the seraphim have six wings, but they don't have four faces. So these guys don't match the seraphim or the cherubim exactly. But if you go over to Exodus chapter 25, when God put the cherubim in the tabernacle, they only had two wings. So the amount of wings in a passage is describing more the function that the writer's talking about than necessarily how many wings that creature actually has. And when he talks about the faces, John is just describing the faces that are out front looking. He's not saying the other one that they don't have other faces. The third one has the face of a man. That's the only one it says has that. So obviously the other one must have other faces too. So again, my own personal, private, individual, subjective opinion is these are the cherubim, the living creatures, back in Ezekiel chapter 1, being described based on the function that they're carrying on at the moment. In Ezekiel, their function is not authenticating, agreeing with the decision of the throne. It's moving the throne. And so the number of wings would be, would you know, have a different kind of thing. When they worship, what they do is they're just declaring, you're right. What you've decided is exactly right. Now in chapter 5, the decree is that the Lord Jesus Christ is worthy to open the book. And the book is the book that opens the judgments of the tribulation, brings in the kingdom, and sets up his kingdom. So he's the one. He says in Matthew, he says, all power in heaven and earth is given unto me. I've won the right to everything. Here's the point at which that right is going to, is the decree goes out that right, that authority should begin to be exercised. In chapter 15, 11, verse 15, it says, now the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our Lord and his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And the decree that put that into motion is right here. This throne is the throne that Ezekiel sees moving out of Israel. They're losing their right to be God's nation in the earth. It's temporary, but it's real. So what he's seeing in Ezekiel is the devastating impact on Israel and the world of their rebellion. Now, when we get to chapter 2, you're going to see that setting turned into a place where Ezekiel is then commissioned to be one of the watchers, to watch his nation, to see whether they turn back or they don't based on the judgment that's coming to them. Literally, he's giving them one last opportunity until the point comes where he finally tells Ezekiel, forget it. No mercy. Passage in Jeremiah, he says, who in the world told you to pray for these people? Forget it. But God didn't do that like that. So the reason that stuff begins in Ezekiel is because he starts out seeing, yeah, God himself is sending us into captivity. The throne is declared that's where we have to go. But it's only going to be temporary because he's still on the throne. Even though we're the crown has fallen from our head, even though we're in the captivity, the Gentiles are running the show now, he's still on the throne and he's going to bring us back. Okay? But anyway, it's for me, it's fun to kind of be able to see how the other half lives, how the throne room operates, and how it works. And to understand that there's all this creation that God has, and God himself, he isn't just arbitrarily saying things. He's got all these creatures, all this creation that he brings into his counsel and works with. And allows to work with him. It's not just a dictatorial kind of a thing. It's a thing in which he educates us to think like he thinks, to rejoice in what he rejoices in, to see the wonderful things that he's going to accomplish through his son, and to be a part of it, and to willingly participate in it, and rejoice in it, and to do what Jesus said, I delight to do thy will. When those creatures in Romans in Revelation 4 worship him, they're delighting in his wisdom. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace, and for a privilege just to be a part of of what you've accomplished and are accomplishing through your Son. In Christ's name, amen. All right, praise the Lord.